becoming the familiar way to do things. So nice to see so many of you online. Those that have their cameras on, welcome. Those who have their cameras off, we know what you're doing. All right. So it's good to see you ahead of another week. It's quite remarkable, actually, that during a pandemic, we seem to be running a show every single week. I think we're busier than ever. I think the cards are stronger than ever. And I think the run-in till the end of the year is definitely the strongest I think we've seen for many, many years. Of course, just coming off the back of Conor Benn and the week before that, history-making card with Katie Taylor. This Friday, of course, Daniel Jacobs against Gabe Rosado and a great card underneath it from the Hard Rock Casino in Florida. And then, of course, next week we go into Billy Joe Saunders' defence of his WBO World Middleweight title. Then we go into the Unified Heavyweight World Champion, Anthony Joshua, against mandatory challenger Kubrat Pulev. And then another surprise coming later, probably with a record defence from Gennady Golovkin. And, of course, already confirmed as well, December the 19th, Canelo Alvarez against Callum Smith. So it's a fantastic run into the final stage of this year from DAZN. And I'm looking forward to the card this weekend. I mean, we have a great card from top to bottom. I think one of the most exciting young fighters in the US at the moment, Nikita Ababi, is in a nice step up. A really interesting heavyweight fight, 2-0 against 8-0. Majidov, one of the standout heavyweights from the amateurs, of course, taking a big step up and moving very quickly in his career against Delgado, who's 8-0. Really good, interesting lightweight fight between Emmanuel Targo and Mason Menard. Anyone that's seen Mason Menard knows he's all action. I'm hearing a lot of good things from Peter Kahn and Lou DiBella against Emmanuel Targo. Of course, he's highly ranked with the WBO, pushing on for that mandatory position. And then a great fight, big step up for what I feel is one of the best young talents in world boxing, in Olympic gold medalist Daniil Yelusinov against former Unified World Champion Julius Odongo, who broke the hearts on a Matchroom show when he beat Ricky Burns to unify the division and, of course, fought Terence Crawford for the Undisputed Championship. And then, I think a great matchup. I love a bit of bad blood. I love two characters and personalities. And Daniel Jacobs against Gabe Rosado is certainly that. You know, on paper, you expect Jacobs to try and come through this fight in style. I know Gabe Rosado's put everything into this camp. It's his last big roll of the dice. They don't like each other. There's a little bit of personal pride as well. It's Brooklyn against Philadelphia. And I think it'll be a great fight, a great build-up this week. Plenty of spite in the action. And I'm looking forward to it. And I thought I'd come on here today to talk about the card and give you guys a chance to grill me for any other questions you might have. So over to Anthony and for the procedures for questions.
Hey, thanks, Ed. Donna first, please.
Hey, Eddie, how's it going?
Good, mate.
I was wondering, we just heard the news from the government that there will be people allowed up to 1,000 indoors at indoor arenas in the UK starting on December 1st in particular areas. Does that impact the AJ and Pulev fight? Are you looking to maybe get some fans into that event?
Well, certainly, if it's possible. I mean, I think the big catch on that is the tier system. You know, what will be what tier, where, how, and what qualifies for what. I mean, there is a chance they could put London straight into Tier 3, which would mean we have no crowds. Obviously, if it falls into the Tier 2 category, then we would be able to have 1,000 people at Wembley.
Have we lost Eddie?
His Wi-Fi may have just stalled
Well, it was good while it lasted, boys.
It's coming back in, guys.
just going back to the question, yes. Depending on what tier is what and what we're allowed, obviously we don't know if London's going to be put into tier three, but certainly if we're allowed to, if Brent Krause will allow us, then yes, we'll be doing everything we can to get that 1,000 number into December 12th for AJ against Buda.
Eddie, before I let you go, I wanted to ask one quick one. What is your take on the Tyson and Jones fight coming up this weekend? And I want to know, are you getting a piece of the action from Jake Paul fighting on that?
No, definitely not getting any action from Jake Paul. I don't know. I think it's hard to criticise people like Mike Tyson and Roy Jones. You know, I think they've done so much for the sport. I just feel that I like to remember those guys when they were young and at their best. You know, I just hope that it's not, you know, a sad spectacle. You know, hopefully they can just have a bit of fun with it, and I wish them all the best.
Thanks, Donna. Reggie next, please.
Reporting.
Hey, how you doing, Eddie?
I'm good, Reggie.
Hey, quick question, just looking forward a little bit. I know, you know, great action this weekend, but, you know, you've championed the value of DAZN to subscribers and whatnot. I just wonder, could you speak to, we're getting to the end of the year, if Krause can't make it back before spring and summer, you know, any concerns or thoughts on what you can achieve with next year's schedule?
Well, I think it's very challenging, Reggie. You know, I mean, look, we are going to be at the Alamo Dome, and we will have Krause for Canelo against Callum Smith. You know, if we can secure the Gennady Golovkin date, we may try and get crowds there as well. We're putting together at the moment a schedule where we don't have crowds, and I think we've got a model in place that means that elite boxing can continue. I mean, if you look at that sort of 1 month period of schedule on DAZN, obviously you have Jacobs Rosado this weekend, but you know, December 4th you have Billy Joe Saunders, December 12th you have Anthony Joshua, December 18th hopefully Gennady Golovkin against Zaremeta, December 19th Canelo against Callum Smith, January the 2nd, Ryan Garcia against Luke Campbell. I mean, that's a hell of a lot of action, you know, for obviously an annual subscription of less than $100 or even a monthly subscription of $19.99. I think you guys, you know, having to shell out another $75 for Errol Spence against Danny Garcia, you know, you've just shed out $75 for Gervonta Davis against Leo Santa Cruz. And before that, you shed out $75 for Charlo. That's over 3 months. That's $225. That's a huge amount of money. And we get criticised all the time, Reggie, in the UK for $30, you know, for an AJ fight. So you guys have got it tough. I just feel that we got great momentum. Obviously, it was a huge catch making the Canelo Alvarez Callum Smith fight on DAZN in December. And I think it gives us tremendous momentum going into the new year. But certainly when you look at fights that are scheduled for probably the first quarter, which is Chocolatito against Estrada, for example, that's a fight that should be selling out at StubHub or the old, you know, StubHub Arena there in LA. It's a wonderful Californian fight night, or even in Phoenix, you know, it can sell out arena. Demetrius Andrade against Liam Williams in Providence. You know, we just did nearly 8,000 in Providence previously for the Selecki fight. And obviously the winner of Luke Campbell against Ryan Garcia against Devin Haney. You know, if it was Ryan Garcia, Devin Haney against Ryan Garcia sells out the Staples Center. You know, if it's Luke Campbell, that fight sells out in the UK or possibly in Las Vegas. So we want the crowds back. You know, there's nothing like the feel of live crowds. But the good news is that we're sustaining a fantastic schedule and we're keeping the momentum of the sport regardless of no fans at the moment.
You think they need you down in Florida? Are you missing being there to add?
I'm gonna come out. The main problem is the isolation, right? So when I come back to the UK at the moment, I have to isolate for 2 weeks, which means that I miss a number of events here, and pretty much would mean that I would miss the AJ fight, you know, which I can't do. But I will be coming to America for the Canelo Callum Smith fight. They're actually reducing the quarantine down to 5 days. From the middle of December, so that will help me greatly, and obviously it's Christmas as well, so that's a big fight for Matrim being involved in that promotion. And obviously Callum Smith is our guy, and we've promoted him from his debut, so yeah, we'll be there. I missed it like crazy. I hate not being at shows, and this will be, I think, the third US show that I've not been at, and the guys have been doing a brilliant job over there, the USA team, it's not easy at the moment, not just with no crowds, but obviously the protocol, the testing, you know, the keeping the fighters safe, and the team there have been doing a fantastic job.
Thank you. The boxing source next, please.
Yes, there, Eddie. Following up on these questions, how has it been going from, you know, fight camp over the summer to booking these fights to these venues with no crowds and, you know, working with people there within Metro Boston, USA? Like, have you gotten used to it? And how has it been as far as, like, not having fans in these venues?
Well, fight camp was something pretty spectacular. I was actually watching a fight back from fight camp last night just thinking, wow, I can't even believe we did this. Like, you know, it was a really unique environment. It is quite sterile in these venues. You know, I've always tried to keep away from doing boxing in a studio because I don't feel like it gives you that big event feel. We've been in Wembley Arena, which is a huge arena. We've booked that out for the last 6 weeks. And in the US, you know, we've been at the Hard Rock, have done a great job with our team there to make sure that, you know, at least you're in a big arena. It feels like a big event. It is difficult, you know. It's interesting that all the fighters I've been speaking to are all saying the same thing, which is it hasn't felt any different. Sometimes I don't believe them when they say that, but I've enjoyed as a purist being part of the production of these events to bring the fans something different. You know, you hear a lot more of the shots, you hear the interaction of the corner team and the fighter, you can hear the referee, you know, you can hear the fighters breathing at times, but nothing will ever take away, you know, the thrill and the buzz and the excitement and the energy of a live crowd. So I hope that, you know, it's going to be, I'm very excited about going to Texas and seeing live crowds back. Obviously, I saw it for the Santa Cruz fight with Gervonta Davis, and, you know, you get jealous. And we seem to be on the verge here in the UK of bringing a small number of fans back, and we hope that escalates, you know, through a reduction in the numbers, but ultimately through a vaccine, I guess, is when the government's going to be in a strong position and a comfortable position in the UK to let fans return, as you know, in full.
Thank you very much, Eddie.
Hi, Eddie. Thanks so much for taking time to talk to us. You know, obviously, there's been a lot of changes in the way people promote these fights during the pandemic. So how much have you been kind of taking the lessons that you've learned from promoting in the UK and in the US with no fans and kind of taking that into these upcoming Canelo Callum Smith fight? And how much do you kind of look towards that fight with fans and think of it as some sort of blueprint for when you're going to be able to do more shows with fans in the future in 2021?
Well, Carlos, we've learned a lot because, you know, we've had to adapt and we've had to think outside the box. You know, every time that you make a major fight, I mean, Canelo against Callum Smith is a good example. You know, you bring the fighters together, you do a multi-city press tour, you know, you bring all you guys out, you know, we get a load of action, loads of footage, we can drive a lot of hype. And obviously now we're geared more towards the digital side and the tech side, which is, you know, stuff like this, but also about content, you know, and working harder to engage the fans with shoulder programming and digital content as well. And we've got a lot of that dropping over the next couple of weeks with Canelo and Callum Smith. There is no doubt, there is no question that a lot of the key moments have been taken away from the promotion of the show. Like I said, that initial start of the press conference, the weigh-in, you know, where you can get live crowds in, open workouts, you know, every Canelo Alvarez fight has a traditional sort of welcoming ceremony and the arrivals coming into MGM there, and those kind of events are big spectacles to really drive the interest of the event. So we've been learning a lot. You know, the main challenge now is when we're dealing with venues, or in America's case, states that will allow fans back. It's not just, yeah, they'll allow fans, just throw them in the arena. You know, there's a method to it. There is safety elements to it. This has to be policed by our security team to make sure that there is social distancing. Obviously, with the Alamo Dome, you're going to have around 11,000, 12,000 people in a huge arena. But, you know, it's our job to make sure that we enforce the plan, that it's safe for fans, because, you know, we do know that it is dangerous right now, you know, to contract this disease. And we have to make sure that we do everything we can. It's not just a case of bringing people back. It's a case of bringing them back safely. And that's what we're working hard to do with the states and the commissions as well. But it is important to start making those moves to bring fans back, because I don't think that there is sustainability for everyone in the sport without fans, you know, especially the smaller hall shows. You know, the small hall and almost what you guys call like the club fighting scene is really driven by ticket sales and fighters selling their 200, 300 tickets to pay for their purses and enable them to get on. Right now, that scene over here, and especially with you guys as well, isn't thriving, you know, because it's very costly for promoters to continue running those shows. So we've learned a huge amount, and it's been really interesting. I mean, you know, painful at times, but I think it's going to put us in a good position when we have normality back and we can use the information that we've learned during this and the ways that we've changed promoting. And, you know, like I said, combine that with the return of live crowds, and I think when we come through this, we'll be in a much stronger position.
Thanks, Eddie.
Hey, Eddie. Thank you for taking the time to talk. I hope all is well. Kind of looking at the current situation, sorry to beat a dead drum. Obviously, with the current situation in the U.S., numbers are skyrocketing. I know that Florida and Texas are allowing fans to come back into attendance, but does that put you in an ethical dilemma of, is it in the best interest to do that, considering the CDC is saying that, hey, don't get together in large groups? How do you work with that?
I think we follow the rules, firstly. I mean, when you talk about morally and ethically, you can't do that without the science and the information, and everybody will make their own decision. It goes back to my comments to Carlos. You know, it's not just, oh, we need fans back. You know, let's just bring everybody together. We're working diligently with the state and with the Athletic Commission to ensure that is